Hey guys, it's VillainTheory, back from the dead, back with a new video series, which I'm really excited to talk about, all about looking at aspects and hero choice and putting them together, kind of, you know, everything you want to decide before actually putting cards into, you know, your deck, before you start deck building. Kind of, I think that's an interesting topic that not many people have really covered in much detail, to my knowledge. Starting with a video just about understanding the aspects. Now, for veteran players, you'll probably know a lot of this, if not all of this. So hopefully it's just kind of an interesting look and breakdown of the kind of, you know, this core component of the game. For newer players or, you know, less experienced, hopefully this is going to be really interesting and kind of expand your knowledge and sort of understanding of what the aspects are and can do. So starting off very simply, we have aggression is known for dealing damage. Justice is known for threat removal. Protection is known for mitigating damage. And leadership is known for its allies. Super basic stuff. Everyone should know this after one or two games of Marvel Champions. But we can break these categories down a lot more and also explore what else the aspects can do, both in solo play and in multiplayer. But first, I just want to focus on leadership just for a second, because what being an aspect all about allies really means is being an aspect kind of about everything. So an ally can attack, it can fort, it can, you know, defend to block an attack. It can basically do anything it wants at any time. So with that in mind, let's go into some of these aspects in a bit more detail. Aggression, I think, can mostly be split down into two kind of categories, minion damage and villain damage. Now, it can do a little bit more than this, you know, it has a few stuns, you know, it has allies, it can, you know, block and do whatever it needs with them, a few forwarding cards, but generally everything it wants to do is sort of oriented around damaging minions or damaging the villain. Some cards can only damage one of those two things, you know, some only target minions, some only target the villain, but a lot of them can target both, which makes them a bit more valuable just because they're more versatile and flexible. But generally, if you want to play aggression, it's because you're looking to add these things to your deck. And then we have Justice, which, yes, it's threat removal, but that threat removal can go into side schemes to control those, or the main scheme to keep that under control. Now, while kind of like aggression has those attacks which can target only minions or villains, Justice definitely has cards which can only target side schemes or main schemes. But although they are less flexible and thus, you know, they're not as versatile, which does lower their value, they are generally pretty powerful at what they specialize in, especially these side scheme specific cards. Those things scale really well. So although leadership being an all-rounder, yes, it has some threat removal, generally it's very hard for leadership to keep up with Justice's, you know, side scheme clearance, which makes it very, very valuable. And it also has some scenario control, things like confusers, which occupy a weird space where they technically, you know, they're kind of main scheme control, they block the villain's scheming. But you can use that defensively, so if the villain's going to attack you, you've got a confuse out, you know, you can just go alter ego and use it up just to prevent the villain having attacked if you had stayed in hero form, which you probably would have done otherwise, that kind of thing. Benefit from the card, you know, the extra card you get in alter ego, I think that's very strong. And you've also got things like global logistics and spycraft, which can mess around with encounter cards, stop them, rearrange them, that kind of thing. Then we've got card draw, which isn't completely universal, you know, in as big of a way as I would say as these other concepts in Justice. But nonetheless, Skilled Investigator is a staple in pretty much every Justice deck, let's be honest. We've got things like One Way or Another, which is very good in solo play, and if used carefully in multiplayer to draw a bunch of cards at a time, you've got Clear the Area. I'm not going to go into specifics of what these cards do, this is not really what the video is about, but Justice has access to more card draw than Aggression and Protection, and not quite Leadership, I would say, but it can do it in kind of a different way, maybe a burstier way. You have a lot of kind of turbo draw decks built in Justice. And what card draw, I would say, mainly does, in addition to just making, you know, more cards in a card game is good, makes you stronger, it's really good for characters and decks that want to focus on using their hero cards, because you're drawing more out of your deck to find them. Hero cards are typically more powerful than aspect cards, so that's a big strength for Justice. If you have a really strong kind of hero kit, you know, maybe a Scarlet Witch or something, and your cards are very powerful, using Justice to draw your hero cards and use those more often is a very strong strategy. Then we have Protection, which is really mostly about damage mitigation. Now, that was definitely true in the first half of the game's life, if you looked at the first three expansions. Now, if you look at the, you know, next three expansions, Protection has grown significantly. However, if you look at all the Protection cards, there's roughly, I say, 100 unique ones, over half of them are still all about damage mitigation. So Protection wants to protect, pretty obvious. But with those cards that came in the later half of the game's life, you know, as I make this video, from Sinister Motives onwards, and particularly during the Sinister Motives wave, we had other options, mainly readying. So if your hero can ready a lot, you know, you can use their attack, their fort, their defense, if it's the timing, you know, in the villain phase. But generally, you know, you can start to attack and fort a lot more if you can keep readying up. Cards like What Doesn't Kill Me, and of course Repurpose, very, very powerful for this. Ever Vigilant if you're an aerial character. And it will depend on your character's stats. If your character has, you know, one defense, one forwarding, free attack. Readying up isn't really going to make you a complete all-rounder. Ever-Vigilant will help, it has some threat removal built in. But in general, readying up will kind of amplify whatever your hero stats already are and let you do more of that. So if you have balanced stats, you can kind of do a bit of everything. If you have, you know, one really high, you know, focus stat, like let's say She-Hulk with free attack, then readying up is going to help you deal a lot more damage. You also have a lot of interesting allies in protection, especially if like a complete card collection, because they're kind of scattered about and get a lot of good threat removal from those. A lot of good damage as well to some degree. So you can really round out protection to be kind of more like leadership. I would say if you're building a damage mitigation protection build, then it is, you know, it's damage mitigation, it's very defensive. But if you're building kind of a more readying up focus, kind of all-rounder kind of protection deck, you can treat it a lot more like leadership. So throughout this video, if I'm referring to protection in a defensive capacity and you're like, but VillainTheory, you can build it as an all-rounder. Well, kind of take anything I'm talking about leadership and kind of apply it to those protection, kind of readying, kind of all-rounded decks. Protection also has some good burst output thanks to Repurpose. This is really only kind of coming about because of one card, but it's such a powerful card that is beloved. I think it's really worth mentioning here in this video, even though it's a general kind of overlook. You know, burst output is very valuable. What Repurpose does, it cannibalizes a tech card. You get a stat boost of your choice, attack, defense, or forwarding, equal to the cost of the tech card that you have chosen to discard as part of Repurpose. Ready up, get that bonus, and you can deal a lot of damage or a lot of threat removal. This is really good because you can combo it with other readying tools, so you get this big stat boost and then you keep readying afterwards to do a lot all at once. In solo play, a lot of burst damage generally wins you the game. In multiplayer, while it can also win you the game potentially, it is really good for clearing the board if you've had a really bad encounter phase. You know, if there's a lot of things out, everyone needs help, main scheme is really high, you can just pop Repurpose and a bunch of readying and basically take care of whatever you need to. So that's a very strong option to have. And protection also has healing. It has Night Nurse, it has Med Team, it now has Angel's Airy. Very interesting cards. You know, Night Nurse is such a staple. It's very, very good. There's a case that it should be put in most protection decks, especially in multiplayer. Med Team is really useful, really good for healing allies. That can combo really well in multiplayer as well with, you know, ally builds, you know, leadership. You can help people, but in general, you can even use it on yourself so you don't have to go alter ego. Every turn you're alter ego, you know, you can't trigger Unflappable usually unless you've got Taunt and so on. It's a bit more difficult. Keeping yourself healthy without having to alter ego can be really useful as well. So this is useful tools that protection has. And then we have leadership, which can basically do whatever it wants to do whenever it needs to do it. Now, that is a bit of an exaggeration. And unlike aggression and justice, you know, it has to ramp up slightly. You know, aggression, I can just play an attack card, you know, immediately and get full value. If I play an ally and want to deal damage, it will do that over a couple of turns as it uses up its health. But nonetheless, leadership is very, very versatile. And that is probably its biggest strength. It is very well balanced, but it can kind of do what it needs to do almost as well as any other aspect. If you really focus a leadership deck on damage, it can kind of match aggression in a lot of ways. If you focus on forwarding, at least at a lower player count, it can come pretty close to justice. And then we have damage mitigation. And what I really mean here is blocking with allies. And while aggression and justice can do this, and even protection, especially with some of the X-Men, you know, protection allies, but leadership really does it the best. It has more cheap allies, it has ways to recur them, it has tools like regroup, which if an ally is defeated by an attack, it goes back to your hand, so you can keep replaying them after that, that kind of thing. So leadership always has multiple sources usually that it can block with, which is very, very strong. Also has a lot of burst output, although this is kind of more specific on how you build your deck. You know, I would say every leadership deck can deal damage, remove threat, and mitigate, you know, incoming damage pretty well. But in terms of burst output, you're looking at things like Avengers Assemble for Avenger decks, Blaze of Glory for Guardian decks, and you can also build general readying decks for things like Command Team and, you know, maybe even Lead from the Front, that kind of thing, for anyone pretty much. So that's a very strong option. Just like with Protection and Repurpose, if you can just clear the last villain stage in one turn in solo, that's super, super powerful. And leadership tends to be really good at closing out the game in multiplayer for similar reasons. And then it has card draw as well, just like Justice. You know, we had Maria Hill in the core set. We've got other allies which draw cards, ways to keep replaying those specific allies to keep getting card draw. Strength in numbers. Generally, if you have a really strong hero kit, if you want to kind of amplify what your hero does specifically, leadership is a great vessel in which to do that. So that'll be my overall breakdown of the basic aspects. We're just going to look quickly at basic cards, which, you know, basic isn't technically an aspect, although it kind of is treated a bit like one in many ways. Everyone can take basic cards. They are mainly known to have, you know, good allies, good trait support, and help you power up upgrades and support some things specifically toward economy. When I say economy, I mean, you know, generating resources, drawing cards, which can be spent as resources, or discounting cards, which kind of, you know, effectively saves you having to spend a resource, basically is generating a resource. So with allies, as we talked about leadership, it basically makes it an all-rounder kind of, you know, aspect. It lets you pad out your deck with anything you need. You know, if your deck is lacking threat removal, you can find it in basic. And then we have trait support, which are cards and things which can only be used by a specific faction in the game. So if your character has the Avenger trait, then you can use Avengers Tower and Earth's Mightiest Heroes to very good effect. Now, there is some flexibility in some of these, and there are cards like the new player side scheme with Next Evolution build support, which can kind of bypass some requirements. But generally, if you have the right trait, you can use these specific cards, which unlock, you know, new bonuses, which other traits generally cannot use instead. Web Warriors and X-Men in particular really, really love their trait-supported, you know, cards. And then, you know, let's talk about powering up. Really, it's a lot of resource generation. There are other things that benefit characters, but really, if you need some extra resource generation, you go to basic and you can find it. Deft Focus is very good for superpower using characters. Heavy Carrier, Avengers Mansion. They're less fashionable and less maybe, you know, competitive than they used to be, but still very, very good cards. And the beautiful thing about, you know, economy resource generation is the more resources you have, the more resource generation you can pay for. So the rich get richer, which, you know, kind of how the world works, sadly, in a lot of ways. But really, it's very strong to do that, especially in the early game, to get some, you know, the more resources you have, the more cards you can play, the more things you can do, the more you win, is a short story. I'll talk about pool very, very briefly. It is the new sort of mini aspect that came with Deadpool. It is fun, but it's very weird to analyze. It has a lot of different moving pieces which don't really form an entirely cohesive package. It kind of just does what it wants, very Deadpool-esque in that way. But it does have some kind of running themes. I would say it's also good at amplifying your hero, a bit like card draw. You can use Mulligan, which is an event which is very weird. It doesn't draw you cards in addition to what you have. It makes you discard your whole hand and then draw cards, you know, up to your hand size. It has to be the first thing you do as a card that you play. So if you're looking for something specific, if you want to get your hero set up quickly, you can use Mulligan to ditch a hand, get a new hand, and, you know, move through your deck quicker. It's pretty good at dealing damage. It has cards like Cut Upper, Get Ragey, Laser Swords, and then you can use Stick Twitiveness to ready up to use the damage bonus from Laser Swords again. Generally, it's kind of aggression light, but a lot more limited and kind of weird. And it has kind of a lot of this high risk, high reward gameplay where it wants you to actually unleash, you know, negative icons on yourself, like Crisis and Hazard, things that are going to make the game harder for you, but then your cards will give you benefits for them being out on the board. Generally, the risk doesn't always equal the reward, so you do have to be quite careful and picky with how you use it. But yeah, kind of a weird aspect, a little bit like aggression, but it has some of that kind of like card draw-esque, you know, amplify your hero, do more of your hero kit that comes with some of the other aspects we talked about. So overall, we're left with this. Now, I want to look at these in a different light by first breaking down what we need in every given game of Marvel Champions, first of all, going a bit more mechanical here. So what the players need in any non-rush game, and rush is kind of a strategy where you just go all in on damage and hope you can defeat the villain before they can defeat you. It's pretty fun occasionally. I'm not a huge fan of it myself, as you might be able to tell by that statement, but a lot of people really enjoy it. It is very valid. It can be very viable, especially with the right heroes and right aspects, aggression and leadership, but this video won't be talking about it that much. In a general game, you are going to need threat removal, damage mitigation, and dealing damage. That might sound obvious, but if you don't remove threat, the main scheme will go over and you will lose the game. And side schemes can be very nasty and cause you a lot of problems, especially the hazard icon, which is, you know, an extra encounter card. Damage mitigation is generally needed in every game as well. You generally have a lot less health than the villain. The villain is going to be hitting you pretty hard every turn. You're going to need ways to block that consistently or heal it, you know, that kind of thing, or you will be in trouble. And of course, you need to deal damage, not only to control minions, but to defeat the villain. If you don't defeat the villain, you basically cannot win the game. That is generally the win condition of every game. So we can kind of look at those again in a different light, and we can kind of phrase them as you need to avoid the loss condition of threat, you need to avoid the loss condition of taking damage, and you need to achieve the victory condition, which is dealing damage. There are two loss conditions in Marvel Champions, one victory condition. And in any given game of Marvel Champions, you need to be able to deal with all three of these. And in solo, you're the only player, so you must do everything. I think it's very common for new or less experienced players to see a hero and think, wow, this hero is really good at this one thing. I'm going to build into that one thing and try and make that even better, you know, really lean into it and get some synergy going, which is a great line of thought for multiplayer. In solo play, you need to kind of be an all-rounder to handle all these different things. So if I pick Spider-Man Peter Parker, I'm looking, wow, he's got free defense, he's got some defense cards, I'm going to go protection. I could stop damage all day long, but how am I going to win the game if the threat is going up faster than I can bring it down, and I can't deal with minions, and the villain's health really isn't going down as fast as I would like? That can kind of lead to either a slow win in the best case scenario, or a slow loss in the worst case scenario. So really, in solo play, I would advise trying to build yourself up as an all-rounder. There is a reason Spider-Man comes with the Justice aspect in the core set. It's his kind of, you know, preset deck to use. It's pretty good for him because threat removal is his biggest weakness, so that really rounds him out nicely. Again, four, people love to build him in aggression. In solo, I think Justice and Leadership, being able to remove threat and keep the schemes under control, is really what he needs. He has really good minion control and villain damage already. Doesn't really need to add to it in solo play. He kind of has enough. You can build him in aggression and do well, but you might have an easier time starting in Justice and Leadership. If you have trouble with him, definitely give that kind of thing a try. Hopefully that's useful to you guys. So in multiplayer, you also want to be able to handle everything, but not as a single, you know, hero. You can split those things up between however many heroes you have in the game. For example, in two-player, you could have Aggression and Justice, with each of them taking care of their own damage mitigation, but Aggression dealing most of the damage, Justice dealing most of the threat removal. And that kind of thing works out pretty well, and you can combine these aspects in different ways. And again, if Protection is built as more of an all-rounder, it can kind of fill in for anything, just like Leadership can kind of fill in for anything. So now I want to go back and look at the aspects again in the light of what the players need in terms of these loss and victory conditions, in terms of these key components. So Aggression has board control, which is kind of the minion damage, and then it can help you achieve victory. It can push you toward the win by damaging the villain. Justice has really good board control in terms of side schemes and is really good at preventing the main scheme from going over, which is kind of, you know, the primary loss condition, I would say. Protection, very good at the other loss condition, just as important to mitigate, which is, you know, running out of hit points. And then we have Leadership, which can do pretty much a little bit of everything, not quite as well as the other aspects in some cases, although in some cases it really can match them. It very much depends on the context, the deck, the player count, the scenario, that kind of thing. Leadership is very, very competitive in all these different facets that the other aspects cover. But that's a little bit of a different breakdown of how you can view the aspects. In some ways, we're just saying everything we've already said. It's a slightly different way to look at it that I think is very helpful. But we can also look at the aspects under a slightly different light. So you can look at Aggression, Justice, and Leadership as the more active aspects, and Protection as more reactive. And what I mean by this is, on turn one of the game, you get to go first. You get to take action and do what you need to do. Aggression can start putting out damage if it wants. Justice can start putting out threat removal. Leadership can do whatever it wants. And while generally, yes, you might want to focus on getting out, you know, key upgrades and support cards on turn one, the fact of the matter is, you kind of have the initial kind of jump on the villain in almost every situation, though they might have some stuff already on the board. But you're kind of, you know, putting your things down to use there and then first. Then you go into the villain phase, and if you want to, you know, stop a villain attack, you can use an ally. Maybe you've already put out a stun, or even if you defend, you're probably not spending other cards on adding to your defense. So you're going into the next player turn with a full hand of cards, which you can then use as you like, kind of taking the initiative there. Protection, on the other hand, can't really do much protecting on turn one. Generally, you can, you know, run taunt and things to make the villain attack you, but for the most part, you can set up to defend, but when it comes to defending, you then have to kind of exhaust on a villain turn a lot of the time, you know, spend cards from your hand. You're then left in the player phase next turn with less cards in hand than any of the other aspects generally would have, which means you're less able to deal with any encounter cards that came in. You're kind of one step behind, where the other aspects are typically kind of one step ahead. And that's not always true, but generally it is a reason why I think defensive protection is generally undesirable in solo play. There are exceptions, and certain characters are really good at it, like Ghost Spider, but for the most part, protection is slightly running behind. And in multiplayer, that's absolutely fine, because it's got multiple other people often, you know, to be able to deal with whatever has happened in the encounter phase, while by defending and helping the other players take less damage, they have more resources to deal with that. So you've done your part, and that's perfectly fine. In solo play, if bad things are left on the board and you don't have the resources left to deal with them, it can be very, very bad and snowball against you. But of course, the all-rounder type of protection we talked about doesn't really have these issues, and kind of, you know, I would call an active type of deck as well. Another way we can look at the aspects is in terms of turn-to-turn gameplay in multiplayer, or what they would like to do in solo if they're able to and there's nothing else, you know, taking their attention. So for Aggression, it wants to prioritize minion slaying. Any when all the minions are dead, should you really be trying to look to put damage on the villain, anything spare can go there. Now, there are exceptions. If you could do, you know, 5 damage to a minion or 20 damage to the villain, you might as well go for the villain, unless, you know, that minion being out is going to cause some kind of game loss to be likely. So, Greshen is always trying to clear the minions first and foremost in almost every situation. There are exceptions, but most decks will be oriented toward that. Justice, you know, obviously prioritizing scheme control, especially good at side schemes because of, you know, what we sort of talked about, that it has some cards that scale really well into hitting side schemes more than other aspects or hero cards can generally do. Protection obviously prioritizes damage mitigation, at least with the typical defensive kind of build. But I will say here, while it should definitely prioritize this, it doesn't want to say, oh, I'll try and do 5 damage instead of stop 2 villain attacks. You know, that's a very bad trade. What you do need to be mindful of is that defending is generally worth a little bit less than forwarding or attacking, just a little bit. And what that means is, with cards like Unflappable and Hard to Ignore, defending once and not taking damage is really valuable. But defending multiple times loses value because you're not able to trigger those cards a second time. So in multiplayer, I'd say defend, you know, once or twice. But for the third or fourth, sometimes it's better to just, you know, have people use their own allies to deal with it that way, status cards, anything like that that you can, because defending multiple times is worth much less than defending the first time. So there is a slight limit on how much you should prioritize damage mitigation. But if that's what the team really needs, if people are like, you know, very low health or don't have a means to deal with, you know, defending themselves at all, then yes, you should step in and do that. You want to prioritize that people aren't defeated, but you don't want to overextend yourself so that all you're doing is playing a couple of defense cards and nothing else is contributing to the game. Then we have leadership, which kind of assists wherever necessary. If aggression can't deal with all the minions, it will help out and clear up the last of them. If justice is struggling a bit with the threat, it will help them out. If protection can't cover everything, maybe it will lend an ally to someone to defend them. It will depend on the leadership's build, but generally it is kind of flexible. It will do what it needs to when it needs to. So when comparing multiplayer and solo, multiplayer actually has a couple of big advantages. In multiplayer, you can pick, you know, your role, your aspect kind of thing, and you can focus on that. You can really specialize. So an aggression deck focused on damage and a justice deck focused on threat removal are generally going to be more efficient overall when combined than an aggression deck that's kind of an all-rounder and a justice deck which you've kind of tried to build as an all-rounder. So that's very useful. And the other benefit is you can kind of help out where needed. So even though you kind of have your speciality, you can help out with other people when they need it. Let's say you have a bad villain phase, you know, the encounter cards are all side schemes, justice is drowning in more threat than it could possibly remove. Everyone can help pitch in with that. So everyone should also be looking to assist wherever necessary, kind of as their third priority after their own responsibility. But if things are putting the game in jeopardy, you need to pitch in where able to. You know, if you're the player at the table who, oh, I'm aggression, I'm only going to do damage and absolutely nothing else. I just like to see big damage numbers. If we lose because of threat, it wasn't my fault. The other players weren't doing their job. I hate to break it to you, you're kind of a bad team player. If you could have saved the game and you guys could have all gone on to win together, then that is on you. So keep an eye on the board. Do what you need to do to keep the game going and get to that victory condition of defeating the villain. Now, you can kind of apply this to solo play as well, this assisting wherever necessary. Yes, if you're playing an aggression deck, you'll be best at dealing damage, but if you're not going to be able to defeat the villain before the threat goes over, you're going to need to assist, you know, with the threat. You're going to need to deal with the threat first and prioritize that. So keep an eye on the board and do what you need to do where it is necessary. And that brings us to the end of the video. Hopefully that was interesting for you guys. Hopefully that was a bit of a different way to look at the aspects and really break them down. In the next video, I'm going to be looking at how in multiplayer you can pair the aspects, both at 2, 3, and 4 player. I don't think that topic is really talked about very often. Some of them are more obvious than others. We're going to be talking about, can you use the same aspect multiple times, you know, 2 justice players in one game, that kind of thing. And yeah, that'll be the next video in the series, probably not the next video on the channel. We have the podcast coming up and I'll be starting a couple of new video series and other things as well. Not to mention a couple of outstanding reviews for new products that I didn't get around to before my sort of hiatus in sort of December and the first half of January. So yeah, there we have it. Hopefully you guys have enjoyed this. Thanks for watching. If you like this and want to see more, please subscribe and I'll catch you next time. Bye.